don't sweat the technique.
Here we go, 50, 45, 40. He may go all the way, 30, 25, 20. 1 minute immediate to 10, to the 5, clears the game. Touchdown, Hurricane!
Don't sweat the technique.
Touchdown, Georgia!
Oh, my goodness.
Let's trace the hits and check the file. Let's see who bit the detective style. I flip the script so it can't get filed. At least not now, it'll take a while. I change the pace to complete the beat. I drop the bass to MCs give weight. For every road they trace is a scar they keep. Cause when I speak, the freak to sweat the technique. I made my debut in 86 with a melody in President's mix. And I'll stay on stronger than refuse to miss. And I still make hits with beats. Parties, clubs, and cars and jeeps. My underground sound vibrates the streets. MCs wanna beef and I play for keeps. When they sweat the technique.
College Game Day is presented by Discover Card, proud sponsor of college football's premier pregame show.
The old OB will be rocking very soon. It'll fill up as the Hokies come calling. Miami one step away from a Tostitos Fiesta Bowl National Championship showdown. In the meantime, welcome to a Championship Saturday edition of College Game Day. Chris Fowler, Lee Corso, Kirk Herbstreit. Special guests throughout the 90 minutes. Dennis Franchione, Frank Beamer, Pete Carroll.
Wow.
Two-game homestand to finish regular season. Keep in mind,
strange things happen
on Championship Saturday. Kirk, you can count on it every year. Something's going to happen.
Something's going to happen. We only have a handful of games today to watch, but I'm telling you right now, you have three conference championships that will be determined today, the Pac-10, the Big 12, and the SEC, and we have 12 bowl games that will be determined today. And as we've learned with the BCS, always expect the unexpected. You never know. You never know what could happen today.
Well, Kirk, I'm looking to see if the BCS works this year. You know, if Miami, they win, it works. If Miami loses, we got ourselves another major league controversy. And some people are going to say, let's take the C out of the BCS and same old, same old.
You're kind of a BCS fan, though.
Yes, I am, but they could
say. We'll talk about the possibilities if Miami does lose. In case you've already put Miami down there in Tempe against Ohio State, remember last year, the Sooners, Gators, and Volunteers, they might have some cautionary advice.
Fields, Jay Porter, Rashawn Woods.
Former, the monkey, is off his back.
Well, in college football, order and propriety has taken a step backward. Chaos reigns.
Chaos reigns. All three of those teams lost as big favorites. Two of them lost at home. That's Miami's situation today. It's finally down to this. One chance to go bling-bling against the Buckeyes. They just got to get the win. All the pressure on Miami. 33-game winning streak, 23 straight in the Big East, 21 straight at home, but the last two have been narrow escapes. So the Canes say they don't need any cautionary tales or history lessons.
My worry right now is strictly on Virginia Tech and not what, you know, other teams have done in the past. I think, you know, our biggest focus is just concentrating and, you know, understanding that our goal's in sight.
You get too relaxed, then, you know, bad things tend to happen. But I'm worried a little bit. You know, it's our last game. They're going to try to stop us. And that's the only way they can stop us from going to national championship if we lose to them.
We have to, you know, be very sharp on our game in order to match, you know, their scheme and very emotional coming in, you know, ready to play to match their emotion coming into the game.
Canes still respect Tech. We know that Tech doesn't belong with this crowd. You know, Iowa State and Vanderbilt and Tulane and Temple, but they all have something in common on this list. They've never beaten an opponent ranked in the top five. Hokies 0-18, 0-5 versus number one. But they did come within a drop two-point conversion for perhaps spoiling Miami's run last season. They did just snap that three-game losing streak, but the Blacksburg bunch doesn't sound scared.
Miami's a great football team. I think the best college football team I've ever seen. Maybe the best college football team ever. But at the same time, I think we'll play well because I think that brings out the best in us.
I don't think it's really intimidating to face any team because, I mean, if you're scared of a team, man, you don't need to be playing college football.
Touchdown, Hurricane!
We're capable, you know, of going down to Miami and beat Miami, you know, on our home turf. I mean, everybody's beatable on any given day.
They don't like us, we don't like them, and let's go play.
Well, Brian Randle is right there if he makes better decisions than he has in some recent games. Tech, nothing to lose, ought to play loose. What about Miami with all the pressure?
Well, first of all, Chris, the only two football teams in the last 25 years have repeated as national title holders. That's Alabama and Nebraska. So Miami, if they can beat Virginia Tech, has a spot in football history that they really want to get. And, Kirk, I think Miami will be motivated. I mean, they have to be focused. And if Tech beats them, they're going to have to beat Miami with their A game. Miami's going to bring the A game, guaranteed.
Well, Miami's been waiting all year long, saying one week at a time as far as talking about a potential repeat for a national championship. They will bring their A game, but I'm going to tell you something. Virginia Tech, Frank Beamer's done a great job of enforcing his attitude and letting his team know you can't be intimidated. Four things that Frank Beamer has to be able to do today to make this game competitive. Number one is they got to be physical against the run, stop Willis McGahee, get Dorsey into obvious passing situations, and they have the athletic ability to put pressure on Dorsey with their defensive line. And then on offense, run the ball between the tackles with Lee Suggs and Kevin Jones. And then they have a quarterback in Brian Randle who he might not kill Miami throwing, but he's got quick feet, he's mobile, he can get out of trouble, and that's hurt Miami this year. We saw Rod Rutherford hurt him that way.
Good stuff. You left out a Beamer ball component, though, special teams.
I say that for you. That's important.
Miami's had three punts blocked and one deflected. They're kind of sorting out that long snapper issue, but Tech almost beat him with a blocked punt for a touchdown last year. We'll talk much more about this. Dorsey McGahee asked who the more deserving Heisman candidate is and the better player of PlayStation. That's Matt Walters. He's a NASCAR freak. We'll explain that. And Frank Beamer. We'll talk about the upset possibilities live with Coach Beamer. Now to the Pac-10 season finale in the Rose Bowl that heavily impacts the Rose Bowl and matchups in no less than 12 bowl games. A couple dozen different teams are watching. They all have their own little personal agenda. Basically, though, it's Wazoo versus the world. The Cougars beat the Bruins. They share the Pac-10 title, return to Pasadena in 3 weeks, send Miami somewhere else, and knock Notre Dame out of the BCS. More on those subplots a little bit later on. The on-field issue, Jason Gesser's availability. He's wearing kind of a funky custom mold brace on his leg. He has been jogging and practicing, protect against that high ankle sprain. If he can't go, junior Matt Kegel is the fallback option.
It's a 50-50 chance whether he'll play or not. I said that at the beginning of the week, and I'll say that all the way up into game time just because.
He makes plays. He's like Houdini. You think you got him stopped, and he finds a way to get the ball out of there, and not just get the ball out of there, but make a play, complete the pass.
They had already had the momentum, and he went in there, and he tried to stop a sinking ship, but it had so many holes in it from when he came in, so he really didn't get a good opportunity. Kegel is a great quarterback. I mean, he's not number two quarterback. He's 1B.
Yeah, 1B wants to redeem himself for the Washington interception that cost him the Apple Cup. He's a cousin of Ryan Leaf. We got more in a quarterback situation coming up, right? Let's talk some scenarios. You want to say what ifs?
Yeah, I'd like to.
What if Miami beats Virginia Tech? We're going to say what if Miami beats Virginia Tech and Washington State wins? Well, this is kind of an out there. You know, Iowa would go to the Orange Bowl, bring all those folks down there, Florida State. The Rose Bowl would be Washington State against the Big 12 champ. We know the Sugar Bowl is going to get the SEC champ, and they would take USC, which has been kind of courting them. I think if Washington State loses, the Orange Bowl can take Notre Dame, and USC will go to the Rose Bowl, and the Sugar Bowl will get perhaps Mark Richt in Georgia against Florida State. I think that Georgia, Florida State, Iowa, USC in the Orange Bowl. I think that makes the best sense.
To me, that
makes the best sense if Washington State wins that game. But a lot of stuff out there.
Well, a lot of graphics, a lot of information, a lot of different scenarios that people are trying to come up with. All I can tell you is up until last year's Rose Bowl with the national championship between Nebraska and Miami, you have to go back to 1946 with the Rose Bowl and the tie-in between the Pac-10 champion and the Big Ten champion. And as a committee, the Rose Bowl committee takes their relationship with those two conferences very seriously. It hurt them last year, even though it was the championship game, not to have the tie-in. So I have to see it to believe it. After the year that Iowa had and the year that USC or Washington State had, to not have them in the Rose Bowl really tells you that it's a different day and age in college football if the Hawkeyes aren't playing Washington State in the Rose Bowl.
Well, let's remember one thing, very important. The BCS was put in existence for one reason only, to match one versus two. All of the other bowls are not about great matchups. They're not about television numbers. They're not about rewarding the teams. They're about making money. So if I'm the Orange Bowl, I'd bring Iowa down there. I'd forget Notre Dame. Forget the Rose Bowl. Forget the TV numbers, because it's cold in Iowa. They'll bring all those people down there, and they'll spend money. And my friends, That is the object of all the bowls except the one versus
you
two.
You just say dog eat dog, right?
Absolutely.
I think sometimes the bowls do work together to set up matchups because, you know, they know they're only going to get that title game one every 4 years.
We'll see.
Now, what if Miami loses? There's a possibility Miami loses to Virginia Tech. We don't know how far they'll drop in the polls or the computers, but if it's not below three, they could lose and still go play Ohio State as a BCS number two
team. That's what you got to be concerned about for Georgia because they're convinced that if Miami loses that and they win, they're going to go to the Fiesta Bowl and play for the national championship. If Miami loses a close game, chances are they're not going to fall beneath Georgia in the polls. The computers are still going to love Miami. Miami will still go to the Fiesta Bowl with a close loss to Virginia Tech.
That's your projection. That's your,
if good. They lose a close one. But you know what? Go ahead.
Forget about it. Ken Dorsey will not allow Miami to lose today. Forget about it.
So you're not even talking about the possibility.
Talk about it. Nothing. Dorsey wins.
I thought you liked the controversial what ifs.
That's not.
All right. Not that though.
Not that.
The BCS Selection Show, Tostitos BCS Selection Show on ABC with John Saunders and Terry Bowden, 3:30 Eastern Time on Sunday. The College Gameday Bowl Selection Special presented by Outback comes along at 6:00 Eastern Time. A complete look at the big matchups. Now to another sort of controversy, the Alabama departure of Dennis Franchione, welcomed at Texas A&M with one of the richest contracts in college coaching, left behind some Alabama players who really pulled together under NCAA sanctions, didn't transfer, and put together a terrific 10-3 season in Franchione's second season in Alabama. For Franchione, he says a very tough decision and a very tough decision to take for those Alabama players.
I would not be fair and if I didn't say that, you know, all of the NCAA things were certainly something that wore on me. It played a major role. And I'll talk to you more about that when we get back together. I want to focus on what's ahead right now. Kim and I have always gone every place with the thought that it would be the last place. But Kim's made it very clear to me this is the last place. So I might move, but she's not. So I think I'm staying.
And we'll talk to Coach Franchione later on in this. He says he at 51, this is going to be his last stop. He has spent 3 years at Texas A&M, or TCU, I should say, 2 years now at Alabama. Here's Ahmad Galloway's reaction representing the Alabama players.
I'm hurt for the younger guys, you know. I think a lot of guys, you know, stuck around, try to see this thing through, you know, obviously with the sanctions and everything. But, you know, what's most important to me right now is that the young guys, you know, form some type of bond, some type of leadership, and keep things rolling.
That's going to be tough. The seniors, of course, move on. Yeah. The guys who hung around there and the recruits who just signed with Alabama, it's going to be tough on them.
Well, from a former coach's point of view whose career went up and down, I think Dennis needed to do one thing, and that was to do the thing that was best for his family, not the University of Alabama, not the Alabama football players. And I'm going to tell you why I say that, and I learned this in my life. No matter, someday in your life, you're going to have a disaster happen, either professionally or personally. And I tell you what I learned, 95% of your true friends live under the same roof that you do. Take care of your family first. Forget everything else.
I agree. Take care of your family.
That's what I say.
You said it was a business decision, right?
Absolutely.
It's about the family. It's about his family.
Family.
And see, I think there also has to be, you heard Ahmad Galloway, you have to consider the Alabama players here. Here's a coach that's done an outstanding job at Alabama. He's going to do a great job at Texas A&M. He has morals. He has everything you're looking for. And I know he's kind of split in two here because half of him feels for the Alabama players. The Alabama players bought in to what he had to offer. With all the sanctions and the probation, they blocked that out, came together as a team. And this coach now has a better opportunity, and now he's going to leave. Those Alabama players are sitting there thinking, you know, wait a second. We bought into the team concept, and we were told to focus as a group, and now, boom, the coach is gone. That's tough to deal with.
Yeah, players are always the losers here. They're the losers under the sanctions when a coach leaves. But keep in mind, R.C. Slocum, the winningest coach in A&M history, boop, he's bounced out of there. Terry Bowden, under probation at Auburn, perfect season, boom, he's run out a couple years later.
Right, it's a different
Mike DeBose wins the SEC, he's run out a couple years later. I mean, loyalty is a tough thing because there's not getting a lot of loyalty from the 80s or presidency.
Yeah, but
he also wins his JS game twice in a row.
Gone.
Yeah, but that's my
bucket.
Favorite.
Yeah, I understand the loyalty from the administration, Chris, but don't forget that the players, we talk about players, stay in school, do the right thing, don't worry about the NFL, focus on the team. by the way, I got a better job. I'm going to go over here now.
I said the players always lose, and that's not fair for them.
Right, don't forget about the players.
I'm with you. We'll talk to Coach Franchione about his reasons, his motivations coming up. We'll also cover the on-the-field storylines of this championship Saturday in Houston, a fourth straight rematch for the Big 12's BCS bid against Oklahoma. The mighty Sooner defense, the Buffs backfield banged up. Third and fourth teamers will carry the load today against Oklahoma for Colorado. It's the heeled up Dogs versus the underdog Hogs for the SEC crown and the Sugar Bowl bid. Will Arkansas's Angels pull them through one more time? And we'll also attack Army and Navy's new recruiting challenge in the new era of unease. That's next on Game Day.
Today's show, presented by Discover Card. Tune in on New Year's Day to see John Gonzer from Cincinnati, Ohio, the winner in the Discover Card Get You on Game Day Challenge. Tradition, brought to you by the Tostitos Tournament of Champions, the 1995 or 1971 Nebraska Cornhuskers. Tostitos invites you to tune in tomorrow on ABC to find out which school was selected the winner in the Tostitos Tournament of Champions.
Today, the rivalry that stands alone. It's a time-honored football game, but it's also a patriotic pageant that becomes even a little more poignant in times of international conflict. The repercussions of Army-Navy are felt worldwide wherever Americans in uniform are stationed. On the field, it's fierce but respectful because players on both sides share a lot in common. Unfortunately, they also happen to share football futility. Both Army and Navy are 1-10 this year, ranked in the bottom 8 in total defense. Navy last in the country in fumbles. Army is 1-12 in total offense. It's really become a trend. In the 103-year history, the three worst combined records are the last three seasons. The obvious challenge, recruiting, with rigorous academics and the 5-year military commitment. And as Jeremy Schapp reports, in a changing, more dangerous world, academy recruiting is changing too.
As the head coach of the Army football team, Todd Berry hears the same question over and over.
Is my son in danger? At what point in time, will he have to go fight?
It's not a question Bobby Bowden hears, or Joe Paterno, or Larry Coker, but it is a question familiar to Air Force coach Fisher DeBerry.
Certainly there are mothers that are concerned that once a young man graduates from here, he's going to be on active duty and he could be in harm's way.
Navy is also recruiting in a world made suddenly unsafe.
Oh, certainly. I mean, there's parents that during recruiting, there's no way that my son or grandson's going to go to the military. And you just move on.
While parents may be more reluctant to send their children to the service academies, the recruits themselves are more eager than ever, according to coaches and athletic directors who say patriotism is surging.
Because of the focus on the academy through, again, what's happened September 11th, I think our application pool right now is up 30% ahead of where it was last year at this time. We expect close to 16,000 applications this year for 1,000 slots.
Those individuals that have a strong interest in coming to the academy have increased over the last year rather than decreased. Now again, you're having to deal with some other issues as far as the parents are concerned and those type of things. But I think now there's a lot of young people out there that are idealists and they want to serve their nation.
It's no coincidence that Army fielded its best teams during and immediately following World War II. It won consensus national titles in 1944 and 45, when more Americans served in the armed forces than at any other time.
If we have an all-out conflict, then, we're going to go back to the draft, and it certainly is better, I think, to be, have the opportunity to serve as an officer in the United States Air Force, Army, and Navy, than it would be, just to be drafted. If we do have an all-out conflict, then, I think probably the safest place to be might be in the Air Force.
Berry says he likes to remind parents and recruits that a young man who's now in high school won't graduate from West Point until 2007 at the earliest.
The world's going to be a lot different than what it is currently right now. I mean, I don't think that what we're dealing with right now is going to be lasting for the next 5 years. And I talk about that too. This might not be their war. It might be, but it's doubtful this is going to be their war.
Still, the academies say they can use this war to their advantage.
This rise in patriotism obviously is going to help all the academies, because I think that young people are looking at themselves a little bit differently. I think the country is looking at themselves differently. It's just unfortunate sometimes that 9/11 has to bring that about.
Coach Barry, obviously optimistic. Air Force really is the model for this. They've gone 12-0 against Army and Navy in recent years, 16 out of 20 Commander-in-Chief's trophies. Players, it's easier to get them there. Annapolis and West Point, frankly, Lee, is a tougher sell right now.
You know, Chris, I was a football coach, assistant football coach at the United States Naval Academy for 3 years, and I recruited the entire country looking for good football players. And it was very difficult to find a lot of good prospects who were willing to serve their country first and major college football second. And after they made that commitment, they had to physically, mentally, and emotionally get the appointment to go to the Naval Academy. But let me know what, Kirk, that was the best 3 years I ever spent. I loved coaching and recruiting the guys that went to the United States Naval Academy. Guys like Tom O'Brien, the head coach at Boston College, he went there, made a life for himself. I love those guys.
You get more fired up for the Army-Navy game than any game we talk about all year. And you do talk about Annapolis more than any other stop that you had, Coach. I think that what's interesting in this whole story is the recruiting and how prior to 9/11, it was the parents trying to talk their young men into, hey, you know, joining, going to Army or going to Navy, joining and going to Air Force would be a good thing. And since 9/11, it's the players, the kids, who want to make a difference, showing their patriotism, and it's the parents saying, whoa, well, maybe that's not a good idea. Maybe we should go to Duke or go over here or go to another school. But they, all of a sudden, that role has changed, and the kids want to make a difference.
Yep.
You know, Paul Johnson today for Navy Lee trying to win his Army-Navy debut. That's something that hasn't been done since 1982 for either side. It's tough to win your first game. Gary Tranquil, they've had six head coaches Navy since 82. That's tough.
Can we tell you why?
It's tough to win.
No. You don't realize how important it is until after you lose the first win, you get word from all over the world.
He'll know.
I know. I found out.
Of course, this Army-Navy game does fall on Pearl Harbor Day when we stopped to salute the many lives lost in Hawaii 61 years ago. On a college campus a long way from Pearl Harbor now sits a tribute to the terrible price paid that day, its recovery and its rebirth, and the man who made it possible. It's quite a tale, narrated by Dan Patrick.
15 minutes after Japanese warplanes first appeared in the blue Hawaiian skies over Pearl Harbor, a one-ton armor-piercing bomb punctured the deck of the USS Arizona, igniting her forward ammunition magazine. A violent explosion rocked the battleship. In less than 9 minutes, she plunged beneath the oil-slicked waves with nearly 1,200 men trapped inside her steel hull.
December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy.
In early 1944, Army Captain Bill Bowers was canvassing a salvage yard at Washington's Puget Sound Naval Station for electric alarm bells when the yardmaster pointed out a large wooden crate surrounded by spent shell casings.
It had a slat loose on the side, and I went over and pulled that slat loose and happened to look in, and it said Arizona 1916. And I said, is this what I think it is? And he said, yeah, that's the other bell off of the battleship.
Bowers, a 1927 University of Arizona graduate, couldn't believe his eyes.
I said, what are you gonna do with this? He said, we're gonna melt it down with all these shell casings. And I said, the hell you are.
Enlisting the governor of Arizona to his cause, Bowers saved the historic artifact from the smelter and convinced Navy brass to donate the bell to his alma mater after the war.
It designates and brings to light the fact that 1,177 officers and men are still in the battleship. They've never been removed.
The bell was hoisted up into the tower of Arizona's original Student Union building, where, for nearly a half century, it has pealed every December 7th and after every Wildcat football victory, except those over in-state opponents, in honor of the men eternally entombed inside the Arizona.
Bowers returned to the Arizona campus on September 11th to ring the bell in a special campus memorial ceremony. He says each time that he sees the bell, he's reminded of the story, the tradition that he started, but also more importantly, he's reminded for whom that bell tolls. When we come back on College Game Day, the players, the moments, the ups and the downs of a wild college football season. And also Miami's Matt Walter providing uncommon intelligence and quiet leadership in Miami's march toward Tempe. We're coming back.
On Campus, presented by Outback Steakhouse. No rules, just right.
Well, down there in Miami, a powerful Tech ground game that's churned out 5-15 the last two games collides with America's deepest and most talented defensive line. Remember Kevin Jones? He did run for a buck 65 on him last year. That's a very critical matchup. Now, the quiet behind-the-scenes leader of that defensive line is senior tackle Matt Walters. Now, defensive line war daddy and engineering scholar don't typically go together. I'm sorry, but they don't. And then you toss in NASCAR freak, as Shelley Smith found, you've got one unique dude.
Miami defensive lineman Matt Walters was raised a few hundred car lengths from Daytona Beach and the Daytona 500. He idolized Darrell Waltrip and developed a fascination for how things work.
In high school, we had a class where we built this plane, this experimental plane, and, you know, I really liked that. And I asked my teacher, I was like, you know, what kind of major would I go into to get to kind of do this stuff? And he's like, you know, mechanical engineering. So I come here to the University of Miami. The first thing I see, I go downstairs and I see an internal combustion engines lab where they test engines and stuff like that. And I just fell in love with it from that day on.
Walters has already earned a bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering, and after this semester will be two classes shy of earning his master's. He hopes to have a career in the NFL, but eventually wants to use his degrees to design race car engines.
As a little kid, I dreamed that I'd maybe be able to drive, but now that I've grown and I've developed, you know, there's probably no way that there's room for a 280-pound guy to fit in a car. I'll take another approach, maybe designing them.
Walters and his buddies are such NASCAR fans, they've begun a ritual on the day of any NASCAR race.
As soon as the clock hits 12 a.m. on Sunday, it's race day.
On race day, a lot of times we only can take left-hand turns, just, you know, in the spirit of the sport.
And if you take a right-hand turn, you got to take a two-minute timeout. We're stupid, so we do, like, pit stops. It's just fun stuff like that.
We only go in through the windows. We don't use our doors, because in NASCAR, they don't have doors.
So the question begs, how do you squeeze a 280-pound defensive lineman through the window of a car?
That's a scene. There's some funny stories about getting halfway stuck in some of the smaller cars, but, you know, you'd be surprised how big a window is.
He fits through my Suburban a lot better, so because the windows are kind of bigger.
I'm actually more into how the chassis works, which is how the car sits on the frame and where the weight's distributed and how stiff the springs are and how the shocks work, more than I am about the engine. Maybe I could use some of the money that I make playing football to, you know, help myself get in.
When we tell you he's a scholar, then we show him goofing around with NASCAR. Oh. When that Hurricane says that he loves Jimmy Johnson, he means the driver. He's not talking about the old Miami coach, huh?
One thing we forgot to mention in that piece is when all the other defensive linemen on the Miami defensive front get most of the recognition, This is a guy who internally between the players and the coaches, he's the MVP. This guy is a playmaker. He makes plays happen, doesn't get all the notoriety, but internally, he's the guy that they lean on. He's been the anchor for Miami's defensive line the last 2 years. Mm-hmm. He's going to graduate with a master's in mechanical engineering with a 3.45 this spring, and he's a terrific athlete, 280 pounds, and he can move. That guy, he's a great player.
Nicked up, he's got a groin. A bunch of those guys in Miami's D-line, you know, Joseph's got a knee. They're going to play Cornelius Green out, but you dig deep in this kind of a game.
Next year, issues
on the D-line.
Big issues on Miami's D-line next year.
Well, tease for the 2003 preseason edition of Gameday. Hobbled Jason Gesser, will he go for Wazoo? What's the plan? We'll talk to Pete Carroll of USC. And, of course, Ken Dorsey and McGee, they said awards don't matter, just winning.
You know, our coaching staff knows we're not in it for awards. We're in it for winning games and, you know, winning games in the future.
On Campus, presented by Outback Steakhouse. No rules, just right. ESPN College Gameday, brought to you by ESPN.com. To buy College Gameday hats, go to ESPN.com and use keyword search College Gameday hats.
This is some good-looking lid.
I got to get some of those.
The MAC championship, Leftwich and the Thundering Herd in their home field against Toledo. That's 2:30 today on ESPN2. 30s, a little breezy for that game. Those teams are already locked into their bowl bids. We know that Cincinnati locked up that bid with North Texas in the Orleans Bowl by beating East Carolina last night. There's some other games. Hey, look down at the bottom.
I was going to say, you look at the bottom. Wow. Florida, Michigan. That looks like a big-time heavyweight BCS
Follows
bowl game. Follows game day on January 1st.
other games, these are the partial bids. At least we know these teams are headed there. Pittsburgh to theinsight.com. There's some good teams headed to bowl games that are, you know, not traditionally for that slot in their conference. Wisconsin to the Alamo.
Penn State going to this year's Capital One. Penn State, you know, player two away from being right in the mix as an undefeated team.
The officials.
Yeah, officials got him.
Sound like Joe now. Now back to the game, pushed back from November 16th to today for television, and also, as it turns out, added bowl drama. More on Gessler's situation in a second, but for UCLA, Tab Perry's high ankle sprain means that Craig Bragg, the lone experienced playmaker, moves to that flanker spot. The Bruins are off a 5-turnover meltdown against USC. They are 5-7 in their last dozen late-season games. Yuck. Washington State gets back the two starting defenders that were involved in that locker room punch-up. Jason David and Ira Davis come back. Jermaine Green, he's hoping, Kirk, that his hamstring will hold up in this game.
Well, and talking to Mike Price, you think about Jason Gesser and the injury. Everybody's talking about it this week. Listen, if you know anything about Jason Gesser, you realize that he will be in this football game. This is a guy that has played with cracked ribs. He's extremely tough. You're going to have to basically pull him off the field to keep him out of this game. But Mike Price says that if he can't go, he has all the confidence in the world in Matt Kegel, that Kegel can get it done. Now, I know most people saw Matt Kegel in the Apple Cup and thought, if he has to play, they're in big trouble, because he struggled in a big way. As momentum was going in the other direction, he couldn't right the ship and change things around. Now, don't forget, Matt Kegel's the same quarterback who had a good game against USC in the Coliseum and beat him back in 2000. So he is capable of getting it done. I think Jason Gesser is going to perform. I think he's going to win this game for Washington State, send him to the Rose Bowl. And I think Jermaine, don't call me Brown, but Jermaine Green will come back and affect this game. I like Washington State to win.
That's a good point, and that's a little touch from inside, but that's okay. Today's Washington State team defensively will use a five-man defensive line for the first time this year. Why? They think they got to stuff UCLA's run, and then they got to put the pressure on Drew Olsen, the freshman quarterback, with exotic blitzes led by number 9, Isaac Brown. Now, Isaac is quick, he's mean, he's aggressive, and boy, he's all over the place. Now, I agree. I think Jason Gesser plays, but he plays only in the shotgun, which is an inside tip for you, and Washington State's pressure defense win this one closer than the experts think.
Well, this really? game has the bizarro sideshow, because you got USC fans showing up at the Coliseum to root for UCLA. They might prefer, I think, some of the UCLA fans to lose the game rather than have USC go to the Rose Bowl. And some of those UCLA fans who would like to see a coaching change might secretly be hoping that UCLA loses, so Toledo gets
it.
There's some serious Hollywood subplots in this one. A guy involved in this is USC head coach Pete Carroll. Your team has all kind of scenarios, coach. Miami's ahead of you, but you might not want Miami to lose, because that could set off a chain that could knock you out. And ultimately, you got to root for UCLA. Does that feel bizarre?
No, we're not. It's not bizarre, because we're rooting against Washington State today instead.
That's how you set it up. Can you give us a key? You played both teams. You blew out UCLA last week. You Washington State, you lost in overtime up there. Give us a key and something to watch for from an insider's standpoint in this game.
Well, for certain, Jason Gesser is such a great football player in their system that if he's hobbled and if he's not quite as effective, that could be the difference. The offense is tailored for he can sit back there in the shotgun and run and throw it from there. So he's got a chance to play today, even if he's limping around. But if UCLA can make him move and make him have to work, it could make it difficult on Washington State.
Coach, you lost two games early. Now you won 7 in a row. What was the key to this turnaround for your football team?
Well, I think we just kind of grew together. Also, Justin Fargus coming in at the Oregon game and really giving us an attitude about the way we ran the football. I think sparked our offense. We really got pretty volatile at the time. Our running game was there, and Carson was just on fire. So it all worked together very well for us.
Coach, Carson Palmer has had one of those seasons the quarterbacks dream about. If you could give you 30 seconds here to state your case on Carson Palmer and why, in your mind, he deserves to win the Heisman Trophy.
Well, he's a great football player. He's had a hugely productive career that's led him to this season. We've played good football around him, and when you've seen our football team play well, he's just been a total star. He can do everything that you want a guy to do. He's got great mobility. He's got a great playmaking ability. He has come up with the big play. Even in the Kansas State game and the Washington State game, he made big plays at the end to give us a chance to win those games, and we weren't able to hold on to it. So he's had just a terrific season, and I can't imagine there's a guy playing better football than he is right now in the country. He's doing everything.
And part of his success has to be Norm Chow, your offensive coordinator. What do you think your chances are of keeping him? His alma mater, Utah, is wooing him as head coach. He makes great money for an assistant coach. Can you keep Coach Chow in the fold there in USC?
Well, we'll find some ways to keep him. I think he's had a great time here so far. He's had a big impact on us. I think he's having a really good time with what we're doing. And so we're going to try to keep him, and we'll do everything we can to get that done.
I don't blame you. Hey, whatever happens with the BCS games, congratulations on a terrific season out at USC and the renaissance there, Pete. We appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
All right. Coming up on College Game Day, we'll talk about Miami's dual Heisman backfield contenders, Dorsey and McGahee. And we'll visit with Virginia Tech coach Frank Beamer. His Hokies, not much pressure there. And of course, Franchione, we'll talk about his new situation at Texas A&M and the departure of Alabama. Beamer and Franchione coming up on Game Day. Another reminder, the Tocitos BCS Selection Show on ABC Sports, 3:30 Eastern on Sunday with John Saunders, Terry Bowden. The College Game Day Bowl Selection Special at 6 o'clock Eastern Time. That's presented by Outback. Of course, the coach of the team that could really throw an 11th-hour monkey in a wrench of the BCS is Frank Beamer of Virginia Tech, gracious enough to step out of his locker room and join us now from the Orange Bowl. Frank, first of all, this week you've called Miami one of the great teams of all time, and right there with 71 Nebraska, the great Army teams. How do you walk in the locker room and convince your guys that they can beat one of the great teams of all time?
Well, I think we have great respect for Miami and what they've accomplished, how good they are, but that usually brings out the best in us. I think we got a group of competitors, guys that like a challenge, and this is a challenge, and I think they'll bring out the best in us.
You mentioned last year, some people think 2001 Miami was one of the best teams of all time, and you come within a drop two-point conversion of beating him at home. Are the guys extra determined because of that game?
Well, I didn't hear the last part. I'm sorry, Chris.
Are they extra determined because they know they came very close to beating Miami last year at home?
Right, and I think we had 5 turnovers in that football game, but this is another game this year. The weather's going to enter into it, the temperature. You know, it's kind of back like the first of the year when you're saying, hey, we got to play a lot of guys. It's hot out there. Well, it's hot down here, and we're going to have to play a lot of guys. But I think our players look forward to this challenge.
You left the snow. Now you go into that humidity. That's as big a home field advantage as there is in sports. Does that come into play, you think?
I think it is, absolutely, and particularly when you've been used to some colder temperatures, and then all of a sudden it's a total change.
Quickly, Brian Randy, your quarterback, decision-making has been an issue in some games. What do you tell him, and how comfortable do you feel about him making a decision with all that crowd noise against that great defense today?
Yeah, it's a rowdy place down here, I can tell you. But, you know, he's played very well for the most part. He's a rookie. It's his first year. He's learning every game. He's made some great plays for us. You don't rattle the guy. He's a very smart fella. And he's a very poised guy. So hopefully he's going to make a lot of good plays today and make a lot of good decisions.
We appreciate your time. I want to tell you that Kirk's already out in the limb. He's already picked Virginia Tech to beat Miami next year when you get him in your place. So that's a little advanced pick.
I hear you.
I know you're not thinking about that, but just keep it in mind. Kirk likes you guys next year to beat Miami. Appreciate it, Frank. Good luck to you.
All right. Thank you, guys.
Of course, so Georgia has been one of the teams of all the BCS. Yes, Fred, I thought I mentioned
that's
that.
Right, that's right. That's true.
You made me nervous there for a second.
Inspirational story
year.
Of David Jacobs is
next
coming
year.
Out.
No way.
I was fighting for my life. I didn't really care about playing football again.
College Game Day is presented by Discover Card. Proud sponsor of college football's premier pregame show.
Tonight, the first SEC championship game not featuring Florida or Tennessee. The Georgia Bulldogs are going to have the house rocking, trying to drown out the whoa pig suey chants. It's really going to be loud if Miami would get upset by Virginia Tech. For Arkansas, a win equals sugar, a loss equals Music City. Enough said. Tony Barnhart, fortunate enough to be at a game today. The Hogs arrived, Tony, with the win streak and I guess a little bit of feeling of destiny down there at the Dome.
I don't think there's any question about it, you know, Chris. In fact, after a loss to Kentucky back on October 19th, Arkansas was 3-3 overall, 1-3 in the SEC, and their season was all but written off. But now they've won 6 straight, and tonight they can win their first ever SEC championship. So, are the Hogs a team of destiny? They say yes. In fact, they feel they have a guardian angel.
Fellas, in this year, you're very, very fortunate because there's been an angel that come down to give you a second chance. What are we going to do with it?
down 17-7 with less than 7 minutes to go against LSU, it looked like Arkansas's SEC dream had come to an end. But the Razorbacks still had a few miracles left.
Jones looking, steps, throws to the end zone.
I feel like it was kind of laid out this way. You know, we could have had it easy and just, you know, ran the table and then come down to this game. We probably wouldn't have appreciated it more, you know. But through all the adversity this year, it goes to show the character of this team. We never give up, you know, even when it's 40-some seconds left in the game.
Now, guys, I need to update a couple of injuries. Arkansas free safety Ken Hamlin, he's had a deep thigh bruise. He has not practiced all week. Coach Houston Nutt told me it was a game-time decision on him, and he says, man, we need him. Now, the news is good for Georgia. Wide receiver Damian Gary's been out several weeks with some leg injuries. He will play tonight. He'll play wide receiver, but he won't return punts. And, Coach, if Damian Gary is back, that just gives that Georgia offense one more big weapon.
Tony, you know, the quarterback, David Green, and Fred Gibson, the wide receiver for Georgia, they've got to be considered two of the best in all of football catching a long pass. You know why? They've caught 16 passes over the last 2 years of over 35 yards. Now, Gibson last week has been sensational again as a deep receiver. And Kirk, he catches the underthrown pass as well as anybody else. Now, listen to this. In the early evening, Georgia's explosive offense and that red zone defense and Billy Bennett kicking field goals, Georgia closer than the experts think in the early evening.
In the early evening. All right. Well, if you look at Arkansas' season this year, you know, the turnaround started when Jermaine Brooks got kicked off the football team. I think it brought them together. They haven't lost a game since. But on offense, they can't throw the football. 108th in the nation. They've relied on running the football, lead the SEC in rushing, and protecting the ball. They have had 434 carries, zero fumbles. So if you're Georgia, it's very simple. Stop Arkansas's running game and go to the Sugar Bowl. It's as simple as that. Here they are. This defense is designed for their linebackers to make plays. Boss Bailey has had a phenomenal year, and Tony Gilbert on the inside also does a very good job of defending the run. Now, I agree with Lee in the first half. Arkansas plays better with their back against the wall, their grittiness, their toughness. Matt Jones making some plays, his creativity will keep this game close. But in the second half, the athletes of Georgia will take over, and I think Georgia wins this game pretty convincingly.
Yeah.
31-17.
Wow.
Dogs. Headed to the BCS.
Closer than the experts
think. Strange things happen in the SEC championship game sometimes. Arkansas is 6-0 if they score first. So you just
obviously, a close game.
That's a key.
Blowout.
There's going to be one Bulldog who is bittersweet tonight. Senior David Jacobs, the former defensive tackle, will get an SEC ring if Georgia can get the victory. But missing the chance to play tonight is going to be terribly painful. Curry Kirkpatrick has the story of how a post-practice headache cut short his playing career, but not Jacob's membership in the Bulldog family.
It was a shock. It was very much a surprise because, you know, somebody that's kicking butt out on the football field would go down.
It was awful. It was awful.
It was life or death, you know. He was on the edge, and anytime you talk about one of your teammates who, you know, you came in here with, it's almost devastating.
Not just devastating. When David Jacobs, Georgia's hard-nosed nose tackle, collapsed at practice last year from a massive stroke, it transformed an entire team's mindset.
The football aspect wasn't even a thought. I was just wondering, you know, was he going to be able to walk and talk and just be able to do some things, you know, just like a normal person.
They said my vocal cord was paralyzed, but I felt like to me I was talking, but to them, to regular people, just felt like I was mumbling around and stuff.
When did you find out that you weren't going to be able to play football?
I didn't really care about playing football again. I just wanted to fight for my life. I liked to be out there on the field, but, you know, it was like another game. I had to fight for my life, get ready for life.
And Jacob's fight to get well began immediately.
I just put it in my mind, you know, I can't sit here and feel sorry for myself. I got to work hard.
He progressed so quickly, you know. Speech and control of his hands came back, and, you know, just to see him progress and know that he was going to get better, you know, that inspired us all.
This season, DJ's indomitable presence at practices and position meetings has contributed to the Dawgs' finest season in 20 years.
And that's why I write 99 on my wrist every game, is because he means so much to me, and the way he played the game is how you're supposed to play it.
We've all had 99 somewhere.
That means a lot to me. That means they let me know how much I inspire them. They just know the type of person that I'm down there. I'm a fighter, not no quitter.
On senior day against Georgia Tech, Rick had Jacobs introduced last and named number 99 an honorary captain.
When I announced that to the team the night before the game, the other three guys came up and said, we'd like David to be there by himself. And so he did that, and it was just very emotional time.
I tried to hold back some tears, seeing them run out.
I'm all nervous and stuff about going out there, back in my uniform and stuff. I'm trying to see, is I gonna trip this time,
If David Jacobs was going to be all by himself out there at midfield as the only Georgia captain against four Georgia Tech co-captains, he was going to make the most of it. After all, a guy's personality isn't changed by some massive stroke, especially when the occasion calls for some massive trash talk.
I was shaking the hand. I was like, well, it's gonna be a long day for y'all. They got a lot of emotion over there. It's gonna be a long day. I'm over there. I can't even hold my right arm. But I'm talking stuff.
He's laughing and joking with the Tech players, telling them about, stomping on the G and stuff. So it was great to see him out there representing us.
Coming back from where I came from, it just gave me more confidence about life and stuff, And I'm just happy that I'm here, and blessed, and a lot of people still by my side.
How about that? He's out there talking trash with the Georgia Tech captains. I don't know how much emotion played a part, but we know what Georgia did to Georgia Tech. And, of course, Jacobs will be on the sidelines in the Georgia Dome there tonight, rooting on hard his current Georgia Bulldog family. Now, the team that would have been in that title game, if not for NCAA sanctions, of course, is Alabama. They have a great season. We'll talk to the now former coach at Alabama, Dennis Franchione, the tough issues about his departure there and his new job at A&M, and also Oklahoma and Colorado. It's a split decision, or at least a split opinion here on who's going to win the Big 12 championship game. That's coming up.
Back in Arkansas, you used to tell me about how it was when you was a boy. Yeah, that story about how you lost your job picking cotton when you was 9, because your hands got all blistered. You said you knew your daddy was gonna whoop you black and blue. You're scared to death of him. Remember?
You got a point?
No. Except, you ever sat down and wondered why you gotta be the meanest son in the valley?
Every couple decades, Texas A&M breaks the bank and does something really dramatic. They paid Paul Bryant a bunch of money to leave Kentucky, give him an oil well, I think, as the story goes. And Jackie Sherrill was paid a fortune when he was brought in as Texas A&M head coach. And this week, they get Dennis Franchione from Alabama. Dennis Franchione joining us right now. Coach, first of all, congratulations on the new job and the new contract. I don't know if you got an oil well in the tail, but You leave Alabama, and obviously there's some tough questions there. There's going to be some wounded players and fans left behind. It's going to be very tough for them to understand the suddenness of the departure. What were your reasons, or what do you say to them?
It's always tough to leave any place, and I don't know if there's anything that I can really say to explain our feelings as a family. We loved Alabama. We loved those players a great deal. I got to a point where I was at a fork in the road in my life and needed to make a decision which side of the road to take and to be able to go full speed ahead. And Texas is a state that I'm very comfortable in, and we just felt like in the long run that this was the best position for Kim and I and for our family as we go forward. We loved our time there, enjoyed it so much, cared so much about the players, and it's always tough to do this, and we understand that.
Coach, can you share with us what circumstances occurred that kept you from talking personally to the Alabama football team before you accepted that A&M position?
Well, you just can't be in two places at once, and the speed with which this goes and the desires that you, the media, have to let this story out as fast as you can. It just makes it impossible to do it the way you would like to do it. I had to rely on some of my coaches, and it's not the method that I wish I could have done, but it was going at such a fast rate of speed, it was about the only method I had available to me.
Coach, you and I have talked in the past about how important it is to get the team to buy in to the team concept, and how I think not only for yourself, but every coach that coaches today, I think that's one of the biggest challenges out there. Your players did buy in. You guys had a great season. Looking back, and I'm sure that some of your Alabama players are out there listening and watching right now. When was the last time you did get a chance to talk to them? And if they're out there listening, what would you like to say to them?
Well, I talked to them earlier in the week, and you know, I would just hope that they would understand that I had to make a decision that was best for my personal family, Kim and I and the girls. But I love those guys. I did my very best every day. I always tried to do what was best for them and best for them as a football team. I cared deeply about them. I did my best to give them an opportunity to graduate, to reach their potential as a football player, and to have a team that succeeded. And sometimes we did it under difficult circumstances. And the players bought in and did a great job of that, and I appreciated them so much and cared for them so much. And I'll always be there for them if they need me, and that may never happen, but it could happen too.
The A&M folks, they do replace the winningest coach in school history. I'm sure they're very excited about you coming in for the most part. Recruiting is a nasty, tough business, as you know. It was in the SEC. It is in the Big 12. What do you tell players who are going to hear it from, whether it's Texas or Oklahoma or somebody else, about are you going to be able to tell guys you're going to be there their whole career, that this is it, that you're not going to leave Texas A&M?
Well, you know, undoubtedly I have moved around some in my coaching career. Because of opportunities that have been presented to me. But anybody that knows me knows that I have no desire to coach in the NFL. And Kim and I, when we reached that fork in the road, it was our thought that I'm 51 years old. We would come here with this being our last job. And whether people believe that or not, you know, I understand. But that is the way we feel, that we have come to a place that we're very comfortable. We thought many times when we do retire that the state of Texas, Horseshoe Bay, some of those areas may be places that we would hang it up with someday. And hopefully I've got a while before that happens. But we plan on finishing my coaching career here.
Coach, we thank you for your time. Wish you the best of luck down the line. We'll talk about your plans at Texas A&M.
Thank you.
Okay, take care. Just down the road from College Station in Houston, you got the fourth consecutive Big 12 rematch championship game. Colorado trying to become the third team in that four-year span to lose in regular season and then win. And people forget, they're 15-2 in the Big 12 the last couple of years. I mean, that's better than anybody else in that league. They're not considered a very glamorous opponent. People would rather see K-State, Oklahoma. Sooners come limping in off a loss. But this is a pretty competitive, I think, good matchup.
I think it's going to be the best game of the day. Although, Robert, you got to look at Robert Hodge and the way he's improved with his throwing over the last six or seven ball games. But this is an offense that still has to be able to run the football and then go to their play-action pass. Every week, defenses know Colorado's going to run the football, and they still can't stop it. And their offensive coordinator Sean Watson deserves a lot of credit for creating running lanes and blocking angles by using a variety of formations. It's very complex, facing 8- and 9-man fronts every single week. And against Oklahoma earlier this year, 204 yards rushing. But if you noticed, that was Chris Brown and Bobby Purify. More than likely, Purify will not be able to go. Brown is out. Calhoun, the freshman, had a good game against Nebraska last week, will be asked to step up and do it again. And I think Oklahoma, Chris mentioned, is limping into this game. And I think their defense will come in against a team that wants to run the football and look for redemption for the way they played last time against Colorado. I like Oklahoma to win, but a close game. I think it'll be a great game tonight.
Are you ready for the last not so fast in the studio of the year?
This is the last one of the year.
Not so fast, my friend.
Okay.
Colorado's offensive line has been excellent this year, and they really run block and pass protect with the best of them. The reason why? Continuity and chemistry. Now watch them fire up, and they stay with their blocks and allow the running back to run the daylight. Now after they do that to Oklahoma, then they're going to play action pass like this and go over the top. Why? Oklahoma has allowed 8 touchdown passes in the 2 games that they have lost. And in their loss earlier to Colorado, Oklahoma, Colorado turned the ball over 3 times and mishandled a kickoff and gave the Sooners 20 points. Not today. Colorado upsets Oklahoma.
All right. You said that a month ago when Chris Brown was healthy. You say it doesn't matter who's running the football.
Who's playing, they're going to upset him.
Interesting. I think it's very tough for the freshman Calhoun and Marcus Houston, who's going to be technically the starter at Tampa. I think it's going to be tough for it's tough to win without Brown.
Yeah, that's true. Okay,
it's got to be Colorado's defense going to have to play the game of their lives.
What are you saying?
I think it's going to be very tough.
That's right.
Very tough. I'll just put my feet up and watch tonight.
We'll see.
Dorsey, McGahee, they'd love to have the Heisman, but it's the national title trophy they want. We'll hear from those guys coming up. And in a season full of memorable moments for Notre Dame, there was none more memorable than this.
40, 30, down to the 25, 40, 50, 10, 5, touchdown, Irish! Barnett battle from Dunningham!
About every decade or so, there's an offense in college football good enough to feature both a quarterback and a running back in the Heisman race. In the 80s, it was Turner Gill and Mike Regier at Nebraska. 90s, Kerry Collins, Kijana Carter at Penn State. And, of course, this year at Miami, it's Ken Dorsey and Willis McGahee. Dorsey, one of the all-time winners as a college quarterback. McGahee, the first-year starter with this year's smashing single-season records in rushing and all-purpose and touchdowns. We ask him which guy's the more deserving Heisman candidate, and the important question, who's the better video games player?
Willis McGahee,
Ken Dorsey,
touchdown, Miami! McGahee, oh, what a run! Oh, what a beautiful throw from Ken Dorsey!
It does take pressure off us, you know, especially on the field, because now, you know, teams have to focus on you know, not only Willis, but myself.
McGahee, 10-5, that's what I'm talking about, Willis!
They can't stop both running game and passing game. They can only stop one. If they stop one, the other one's going to pick up the slack for the other one. The only talking we do is, you know, when I tell him he's going to win it. I think he's definitely deserving of it because, you know, there have been games where, you know, he's put the team on his back and, you know, been able to run the ball and, you know, he's won a lot of games for us.
What a run by Willis McGahee, and the Hurricanes are right back in it.
I wouldn't mind if he won it, that's for sure. I'll vote for him because, you know, he's been there longer than I have. This is my first year, you know. I don't think a first-year person deserves it. He's a great player. He's smart. He's an excellent quarterback. A good person to look up to, you know. I take my hat off to him because he's been here. He's been doing his thing. He lost one game since he's been here. The only talk in the locker room is, you know, it's not about the Heisman. It's about, you know, me beating him in video games all the time. And that's about it. So, you know, that's all the team knows is my success at the video games. Right now, he's up one game, but fortunately, he's been scared to play me lately, so, you know, that's the type of person I am, you know, people scared of me. So, you know, I ain't gonna take no slack off of him. If he's scared, he's scared. Just say it. And when, you know, Willis conveniently forgets his PlayStation and conveniently forgets to bring it to the hotel, you know, we know who's scared. There's a challenge of a best of three series up in New York, so
yeah.
I plan, you know, a nice two-game sweep and be done with it.
Tony Barnhart, I'm not going to ask you about your video game skills because I suspect they're about as good as mine, but give me your Heisman ballot, 1, 2, 3.
Well, Chris, I've been saying for about several weeks now, I think Brad Banks is the most dynamic player in college football right now, so I've got him number one. Penn State's Larry Johnson, I think 2,000 yards in the Big Ten is an incredible accomplishment. And, Kirk, I think Ken Dorsey deserves some love for us, so, Kirk, I've got him at number three.
Tony, it's interesting, top three, and I cannot believe you don't have Carson Palmer at least in the top three. Here's a guy, we're all searching the entire nation the last 5 or 6 weeks of who is the Heisman Trophy winner. All Carson Palmer has done in the last six games, 334 yards per game, 23 touchdowns, 4 interceptions, 4-0 against ranked teams, and played his best game of the year against Notre Dame last week. He put an exclamation point on his season. Carson Palmer, I think, deserves the Heisman Trophy.
Great shot, boy. He's a great shot. Now, I take Ken Dorsey. The reason why, he makes everybody around him better. In the big clutch games, he plays his best, and he's the quarterback of the number one team in the nation that's undefeated. Ken Dorsey, my pick.
You've made your case. Okay. I have not made it my mind. I'll fill the ballot out, and even if I had, it wouldn't tell you or you
That's smart.
Now let's get to the final chance for Dorsey and McGahee to make their Heisman case, and more importantly, take on a very good Virginia Tech team. Break it down for me today.
Well, first of all, Ken Dorsey's been passing the ball wonderful, so you would think if he were Virginia Tech, you want to stop his pass and you can beat him. Ha, ha, ha! Not so fast, my friends. Wait, they won't. I didn't even get a chance to do it.
Sure.
Now, when Virginia Tech wins, they stop the run.
Mm-hmm.
When they lose, people run on them. So McGahee should be sensational today. Miami's at home. It's hot down there. They got a chance for the history. Miami wins only by two touchdowns.
This only, could be only, a, by, yes, two only touchdowns. By two touchdowns. Okay, all right. You know, we've talked all year about Miami's defense. They're the only defense remaining in college football that plays their base package, seven guys up front to defend the run, mm-hmm. but they keep two safeties deep to prevent people from throwing the ball deep downfield on them. Now, if you're Virginia Tech, what you have to do is run at that front seven right into the box area, and please don't try to bounce it to the outside. Run right up the middle with those safeties deep. And this is Syracuse last week. Look at the safeties. They're nowhere to be seen. And by doing that, it gives you a little bit of room that if you can run at them, win the battle up front against that front seven, you got a chance. Now you can make Miami make some adjustments. Talking to Mark Stoops, the defensive back coach, now they got to walk their safeties up to about 8 to 10 yards up the line of scrimmage, man-to-man on the outside. Now when you get man-to-man on the outside, it comes down to can your receivers beat their cornerbacks and can your quarterback have time to throw? This is Rod Rutherford, who again had time to throw here, makes the big throw on third down for the first down. And the other factor to keep in mind in this game, because I don't know if Brian Randall's going to have a whole lot of success throwing the football, he might underneath but not deep, is he's got to be mobile. Create positive plays when it looks like a sack. Rutherford has done it. Other mobile quarterbacks have done it. It's your only chance when you face the speed of that Miami defensive line. Miami wins, but closer than Lee thinks. I think it's going to be a close game.
Two touchdowns, pretty close.
That is, in Miami terms,
good
that
stuff
is close.
There. I don't think they have Larry Fitzgerald, though, as a receiver, Virginia Tech, like we saw in that video.
That guy's good.
That's one. Proof that I'm wearing pants is coming up. If you wondered about that. We've got a little roundtable discussion, some of the moments of the year here, including the LSU miracle down in Lexington. We're all wearing pants.
We're all wearing.
FYI.
Jeez.
Time now for the Rapid Fire Roundtable. Trev Alberts joins us. I'm Alex Trebek, so please answer in the form of a question. Contestant number two, the best game you saw this year?
Ohio State, Michigan, fierce competitive game. But you know what? As hard as those players played, not one ugly incident between them. I got a lot of respect for the Michigan-Ohio State players, the way they played the game.
I told you that game was about respect into it. It's not a nasty rivalry. I thought the Miami-Florida State game was a game that stood out to me. Florida State played very well. Miami fought back to take the lead, and then once again, wide left just by that much and saved Miami the season.
What about LSU-Kentucky? Kentucky fans were coming on the field. It was over, and all of a sudden, Marcus Randall, Devery Henderson, it was the most unusual play. It wasn't even a Hail Mary. Catches it, touchdown. To me, that was the best game.
Arizona State over Oregon, if you like those Pac-10 shootouts. Best individual performance of a game?
Best individual performance to me by a true freshman, Reggie McNeil against Oklahoma. Remember, Oklahoma was number one in the country. A&M struggled all year at Kyle Field, and they went in and got it done with a true freshman, Reggie McNeil.
I just got an individual play. Maybe not the whole game, but what about David Pollock at Georgia against South Carolina? Remember, he got the interception, the fumble, touchdown, all in one play. It's like everybody standing around going, what just happened? He got the ball, he sacked him, but it's a touchdown. But it was a great individual effort by David
Rex
Pollock.
Rex Grossman at Tennessee in the rain, handled the pressure, and he willed Florida to a win by himself.
Brad Banks at Michigan, that was the most dominating team performance. They beat Michigan in the Big
House. That was the basis of my Iowa argument.
That's right.
Most memorable play.
Is there any other play other than the play that Charles Rogers made? I know they lost a game. Charles Rogers made the catch of the lifetime for any of us at any level of football. Went up on 4th and 11, not only to make the catch, have the presence of mind to get his foot down and to give Michigan State the lead with just a minute to go in the game.
Mine was the Michigan kicker. Remember the place kicker? He sat down, boo, he gets up, Phillip Rabs kicks the winning field goal.
Washington game,
In the Washington game, and he becomes GOAT the hero with one kick.
Mine was Michael Johnson. How about Georgia? Remember, he hadn't played much of an impact this season against Auburn. All of a sudden, in the end zone, had to have a touchdown, comes up over the defender. Great individual effort from Michael Johnson.
All right, biggest disappointment is Nebraska at 7-6, 3-5 in the league, or Michigan State's meltdown where they just quit at the end of the year.
Well, all of those. My biggest disappointment is Franchione left Alabama. That's another issue. Okay. But Iowa State, team that's 6-1 in the top 10, all of a sudden, where are they going to go? BCS game, finish the season 7-6 and a Heisman Trophy candidate.
The schedule on the back end caught up to him. To me, it's Tennessee. Chris and I felt that Tennessee might get to the national championship game. Number 4 in the preseason polls. All the injuries. I think they had 65 starters, or 65 games the starters missed. Injuries killed Tennessee. Big disappointment.
To me, it was the Arizona players and their mutiny. I mean, they went against John McAfee publicly. They should have never done that. Yeah. And then the administration allowing them to do that, to embarrass themselves, the school, and the administration.
Not to mention this week. That's a whole nother story.
Disappointment. Officiating was terrible this year, and the reaction to the officiating by a lot of coaches, including Joe Paterno.
Joe Paterno, worst call of the year was Penn State and Michigan. Yep. Penn State's right about at midfield, driving, game's tied, about 49 seconds to go, and Zach Mills throws it to Tony Johnson, 22-yard gain in perfect field goal range. Out of bounds.
I thought the worst call of the year, and it didn't have an impact on the game, was Florida State and Notre Dame. Remember when all of a sudden Chris Ricks throw the pass to Robert Morgan? He ran for like 5 steps, and all of a sudden Shane Walton, he strips it, and then all of a sudden they call it incomplete pass. They go down and score. It's 10-10.
Washington State, they cost Washington State, that official did. The Rose Bowl guaranteed and a shot at the national title.
Redemption today.
Redemption. Bad.
Defining moment, Trev. What defining?
I thought the defining moment was USC's victory over Notre Dame. I really did. At the end of the season, we found out that Pete Carroll has this team back. I mean, to beat Notre Dame the way they did, I thought that was a great exclamation point.
Don't forget about the way Carson Palmer, that was a season defining moment for him. Yeah. I think it was the Ohio State-Purdue game, 4th-and-1. Here's a team at Ohio State that got to the national championship 5 times, had to come back in the fourth quarter. 4th-and-1 against Purdue, up and over by Craig Krenzel to win the game.
The feeling I had was when we walked into Franklin Field for College Game Day. And let me tell you something, all those great players, that tradition, that history, and I got to put on Ben Franklin. That, to me, was the best I've ever done. I love that.
Oh, yeah, Ben Franklin. Ohio State, Michigan, I think the history, the nemesis Michigan right there, the tension, the holding your breath every play, and then finally the release when they won it in the final second. Had to be there.
Stuff.
And USC missing an extra point at Wazoo in regulation. We shouldn't be in this BCS mess. We wouldn't be in the mess if they kicked that extra point.
Right.
We'll be back.
We killed them.
From the BCS to BC college basketball, Troy Bell and the Eagles coming up against UMass right after we're done.
Today's show, presented by Discover Card. Tune in on New Year's Day to see John Gonzer from Cincinnati, Ohio, the winner in the Discover Card Get You on Game Day Challenge. And in part by Best Buy. For the latest technology, turn on the fun at Best Buy.
Get the Canes in the house. Where's the whoop whoop? Kirk, you're supposed to chime in there. Are they going to make it to the Tostitos Fiesta Bowl in Tempe? We hope you'll join us. A special, it'll be like that. It'll be just maybe not quite dawn. 6:30 Pacific, 9:30 Eastern Time, leading into the Florida Michigan game, the BCS Championship preview show, right before the game on January 3rd. Attention on the bridge, Admiral Corso is here.
Permission to pick this game, sir.
Permission granted.
35 years ago, when I was a Navy coach, we beat Bin Army. This is what I won. Go United States Naval Academy.
How do you follow that? You
always I'm going with the robe. I like Army to beat his Navy team.
You're going against the robe.
This robe.
Army gets their second win of the year. This robe is
older than you.
You're right.
It is.
I'm going with the robe.
Thanks for watching us the entire year. We'll see you from Tempe. College basketball is coming up next on ESPN. Dismissed.